1984. Did you read that by George Orwell?
Yeah.
Remember how they remove the meaning of words? So you don't have the strength to identify what's going on. Not only that, but then you comply to what they put on you. It's a manipulation, as I said, a manipulation of your minds. And taking away your thinking tools is part of this manipulation of your minds to control you. Yeah, I did my daily prime on this today, and it really got me thinking about thinking tools and how thinking tools are words. We know that. And that's why keeping the meaning of words accurate is so important. Because if you don't, then you start losing your thinking tools, and that becomes a weapon for the cult, the ruling class, to control you. So you must keep the definitions of words accurate. But even more so is how you put those words together. You can put those words together into concepts, and then you can take those concepts and put them together like pieces to a neo-think puzzle picture. So today I was just thinking about that. We have this word cult. I started thinking, well, what really is a cult? And I realized, putting together the proper words and the thinking tools, a cult is controlling people's lives through manipulating their minds for the benefit of the leaders of the cult. And as I started putting those words together to describe or define cult, I began to realize, well, that's the exact definition of the ruling class in our country today. They control our lives and they manipulate our minds to benefit the leaders. And a very startling statistic is if you look at what politicians who've been in politics for a while, what they're worth, and you compare that to when they went into politics. Now, and then you look at their salary as politicians. You say, well, how did they go from basically being worth going in $100,000 to being worth $35 million, for example?
Pelosi, 200 million.
There you go. How did that happen? Because they're on a set salary. So, like if you're in any business, any job, your wealth stays consistent with your salary. Why is it always politicians become multimillionaires with these, relatively conservative salaries? Why? Because they are a cult and they are benefiting themselves off of controlling and manipulating the people.
So usurping the values of the people that they're supposed to be helping.
That's right. And then I started thinking, okay, money, money, money. And then I started, okay, using our thinking tools, I started thinking about taxes. And I said, wait, this is another piece to the puzzle to build a neo-think puzzle picture. And I was thinking about taxes relative to the annual deficit, which is over $2 trillion now, and the national debt, which is $36 trillion. So I started looking at all this and using these thinking tools and putting them together into concepts and snapping them together into puzzle pictures. I realized that that's exactly what a cult does. It usurps and takes out all the money it can from the people in the cult. Again, to make the leaders rich and powerful, wealth and power at our expense. You see, when you start looking more closely at your thinking tools, cult, manipulation, money, taxes, and you start putting them together into like a puzzle picture, you begin to see that the ruling class is a bunch of leaders who are controlling and manipulating the people in the cult, that's the US citizens, for their own benefit. That's going from $100,000 to $200 million. So there's your picture, your puzzle picture. We're trapped in a cult, and the leaders are getting filthy rich and powerful from the people trapped in that cult.
Well, how do you escape that then?
Well, I started a new country, a digital country named Immortalis. And the whole idea there is to, well, in 10 years, we want to have land and we have approaches and ways to go about this and eventually sovereignty. But the whole constitution, the whole idea behind Immortalis is that there is no ruling class. So don't have a cult. Everything's mutual value exchange. You have a prime law, a law that forbids any initiatory force among not only civilization, but within the government. So you're forever free of the cult, and your money is not going to be sucked away from you to benefit them, to give them power and wealth. You're going to keep all your own money. As a matter of fact, you're going to grow wealthy in this country, and there will be no taxes. There will be a voluntary pay, because you'll suddenly find yourself being quite wealthy. And you'll want to pay for that which enables this to occur, the conditions to occur, basically for protection.
You're paying. So it's like buying a service.
Right. It's just like buying a service, and everything's a mutual value exchange. So,
like buying water.
Yeah.
Electricity.
Yeah.
Protection.
Yes, exactly. If this protection service is failing you or not living up to good standards, well, along comes a competition, because everything's based on mutual value exchange. You can live in a country like that, you can be safe, and you will be wealthy and healthy, because with no more government regulations being put on all the people, everything's going to soar in all industries, including the health industry. We're going to cure cancer, we're going to cure heart disease, and we're going to cure aging and death itself. Realize this all came about just by using thinking tools, by using words.
Let's back up for a second. Can you explain what that really means, words being thinking tools?
Well, one of the things that governments and cults try to do is they try to lose meaning in words.
What do you mean?
Well, a great example is 1984. Did you read that by George Orwell?
Yeah.
Remember how they removed the meaning of words?
Yeah, so they changed the definitions.
So you don't have the strength to identify what's going on. Not only that, but then you comply to what they put on you. It's a manipulation, as I said, a manipulation of your minds. And taking away your thinking tools is part of this manipulation of your minds to control you.
So you're saying people think in words, and words need to have meaning. Otherwise, if they're obfuscated or distorted, then you can't properly think. And yes. I see that a lot, actually. You know, the media and, you know, certain politicians and groups try to change definitions of words to confuse you. And so when you're thinking in your head and the definition is now changed and confused, that just confuses your thinking. So that makes a lot of sense.
Yes. I mean, and some of the words they throw out at you, like misinformation, disinformation, they use that as a way to attack freedom of speech. They call free speech, they'll say, because it disagrees with their manipulation and controlling your life, they'll say, that's misinformation. So they pull away from you freedom of speech, freedom of using words. And there are words that are sophisticated words, but the average person doesn't know what it is because it's been distorted. For example, the word capitalism.
Yeah.
Capitalism, on this planet, we've never had capitalism. It's never
true
existed.
Capitalism.
Right. It's never existed.
What have we had?
We've had variations of government control. When you have any initiatory force in the governing body, you do not have capitalism.
What do you mean initiatory force in the governing body?
Where the government can use force on its people, which it happens all the time. And it's always happened in ruling classes. That's why they call them a ruling class. So they can use initiatory force. And as long as you have that, where government can put regulations on a company, say, you can't do that, you can't do that, you can't do that, you can't drill, you can't do this. Well, those are initiatory force. Those are regulations holding back progress. You don't have capitalism.
And blocking competition.
Right. I'd say the closest we've ever come to capitalism was early America. But we didn't have capitalism. Without the prime law, you can't have true, pure capitalism.
Which just means mutual value exchange.
That's what it means.
Meaning everyone has the right to build their business and make it more competitive. And if you, like, no one's going to stop them, and it's basically may the best value win.
Right, which is the greatest thing for the consumer, for the person.
And so what's wrong today with that? Like, why don't we have that?
Well, because we have a ruling class full of initiatory force. So we have regulations burdening businesses. The energy The energy industry is a great example. We can't get our own oil that's all right beneath our feet because of regulations, initiatory force stopping businesses from freely doing what they can do best in mutual value exchange circumstances.
And so basically it's just stop letting the government tell you what you can and can't
right.
do. And
that's going just back it. To our thinking tools, we have to be able to call the government a cult, a ruling class that that uses initiatory force on the people, that tax the people. How do they tax the people? Voluntarily? Do we voluntarily pay our taxes?
You'll go to jail.
Right. Initiatory force.
Okay.
So these are thinking tools. Now we know that our taxes are coming from a cult through initiatory force. We have to pay it or we go to prison. That's initiatory force. And the politicians get rich off of our suffering.
And there's no
thinking tools.
And there's no real incentive for the government to actually provide a valuable service because they're forcing the people to pay them for a bad service or for a service, whether the service is good or bad.
And that bureaucratic state gets bigger and bigger and bigger, more and more sloppy and destructive every single year. The only valid purpose of government, going back to our thinking tools, is to protect the people. There's no other purpose of government. But look at how it's exploded and expanded the bureaucracy to get more money off of us so they can live with wealth and power as we sink in status, wealth, and power to live the life the way we want to live our lives.
It's really disgusting when you think about it.
Immortalis. I have one word, one answer. Immortalis. I'm done with this ruling class. You know, I've tried to, over a dozen years ago, try to bring the prime law to our country from the inside with a third party called the 12 Visions Party, the TVP. The whole idea behind that was to promote the 28th Amendment, the prime law is the 28th Amendment to our Constitution. Because once you have the prime law that forbids initiatory force, even as an amendment, everything, all law, all regulation, everything has to pass through it.
And the prime law, what does it do?
It filters out any bad law or regulation that uses initiatory force.
So it just says initiatory force is illegal,
that's
period.
Right. So it's like okay. A big filter. So it becomes the supreme law. It becomes the Constitution de facto. That was the beauty of the 28th Amendment. By the way, anyone can go to the 28thAmendment.org to read the prime law.
That's the 28th, the 28th.
Oh, I have both.
Okay.
Yeah. So just go to the 28thAmendment.org if you want to actually see the prime law. It's short and sweet, but it protects the individual. There's no minority smaller than the individual, so everyone's protected equally. There's no more minority this or that or racism, no more anything. It's just the individual is protected and all are protected equally. So when you have the prime law, it removes initiatory force from government itself. And that will be the first time you'll ever experience true capitalism in a society. The first time society will be free to rise to the great wealth and health and safety, peace, where it's supposed to be.
So it seems like that's how humanity is supposed to live, how it was always meant to live. But then, you know, just everybody being free to pursue their own happiness, to be able to do whatever the heck he or she wants, as long as it doesn't hurt anybody else or their property or contract. But in the process, like on the way to how we were supposed to live, how we are meant to live, evil, it seems like evil characters have got in between that and have blocked that, creating a ruling class backed by force.
Yeah, and that all came about because they're looking for the shortcut without putting out the work and effort. They're these type of people who are looking for the shortcut, aren't looking to put out the actual honest effort and value creation that's required of individuals. They're looking for the shortcut just to get to the top and live off of other people. It's power hungry, dishonest, and believe it or not, lazy people. Those people up there, those politicians, They aren't hardworking people. They may be stimulated and excited because they have all this power and wealth, but they're not. They're lazy people. You look at some of them talk and you say, those are empty vessels. They really didn't get in there and really learn business. Now, you put a businessman up there and you can see the difference immediately.
Right.
That was, by the way, the idea behind my first, my very first experiment in politics. It happened even before the 12 Visions Party. This happened, in 1992. I put out a little exploratory committee for a presidential run. I bought infomercials on television. This was just before Ross Perot kicked in, and I was doing infomercials, and things were going quite well. I called it the People's Party for Economic Prosperity, and that was before I really understood the significance of the prime law. Although I had the prime law, I didn't realize fully the power and the importance of the prime law. So my whole party was based upon reducing regulations, curing regulations, and my whole—
Which regulations are backed by force.
Correct. And my whole— But back then, though, I didn't fully understand that yet. I was, in fact, I was a year too young to run for president. That's why I was an exploratory committee.
How old?
34, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah.
You have to be 35?
Yes.
For some reason, I thought it was 36.
Yeah, I think I was 33, and I would have been 34 by the time of the election, a year too young. But
so you're just dabbling.
I was just experimenting, right? And yeah. I did door to door myself and talked to people face to face. And I had just made an observation at the time of how much bureaucratic regulations were just holding back everything in our country. So that was what it was based upon. Basically, was removing these regulations. It was later when I realized the potency and the power of the prime law that just takes out the fundamental underneath it all that allows all that, and that's initiatory force.
So with what you're just saying is, so initiatory force is, how would you describe it? It's like
it's the fundamental
crux of the power,
yeah,
of the rulers and leaders. Initiatory
right.
force is the only thing that actually gives them that unearned power to be able to usurp values from the people.
Yes.
That's the only weapon that they have against everybody else.
Yes.
So if you remove that, then there's literally nothing. Then they don't have any actual power unless they produce competent values, unless they actually create values, which they're not doing now.
When I recognized that, my whole world went silent for several hours when I realized that the answer was the prime law. I was sitting in a Starbucks and I was writing and dealing with all the regulatory bureaucracies and trying to figure it all out. And all of a sudden, what you just said hit me. That I've had it all along. It's sitting right under my nose, right here. It's the prime law, and everything will change because of the prime law. We will have what I call the civilization of the universe on Earth, civilization of the universe. That was first developed, that concept, by my father, who was the discoverer of Neotech, the Neotech idea system. And he pointed out how civilizations that survive their nuclear decision threshold, where they, all conscious civilizations will reach a point where they have the nuclear power to wipe themselves out. And in order to survive that threshold, they must get rid of all irrationality, all mysticism. And I realize the prime law is the point of singularity that we must pass through. That's what will enable Earth to enter the civilization of the universe. But wait, before I go off on that, I wanted to finish what I was saying about in 1992. I was doing this little exploratory committee, knocking on doors, running infomercials on TV, and giving away a book called A Future of Wealth Belongs to You. It was my manifesto at the time.
Do you still have that?
You could probably find it online. It's out of, I mean, it all sold out and it's out of print now.
Okay.
But you might be able to find it.
Is there a digital copy, you think?
No, I don't think so. That's okay. Old, and it would, because I went beyond that once I understood about the prime.
So it's not no longer relevant now?
No, it's not.
If somebody's interested in learning more, about all this stuff, what should they do?
Wait, let me finish.
Okay.
Let me finish my thing about 1992. So, I realized that before I realized the power and the importance and that how everything, the point of singularity was the prime law, I realized that the immediate fix on civilization would be replacing career politicians. And by the way, career politician was not that commonly used yet in the political. I mean, people have used it, but it wasn't so common as it is today.
You popularized that term.
Well, Ross Perot popularized that, but I'm going to tell you in a minute what happened here. My manifesto says how the career politicians must be replaced with market businessmen. Now, market businessmen are different than political businessmen. Political businessmen cozy up and have a revolving door with government, and they get advantages and rights away. They get
basically
privileged treatment.
Right. Quid pro quo.
Right,
you know, exactly. You treat my business fairly, reduce competition by passing these regulations, and then when you get out of government, we're going to put you in a nice position.
Yeah, and that's exactly what it is. It blocks out competition. And so,
again, using force.
And those are political businessmen. But market businessmen have no interest in getting political advantages. They're the heroes of society. They're out there just trying to provide the greatest value for the cheapest prices, and they're in the arena competing with others, and they're trying to offer more value and drive down their cost or their prices to sell more and bring more values to society. They're value creators, the market businessmen.
I mean, just to prove that, I got a Tesla like 6 years ago, and then 4 years later, I got a new Tesla, and the price was actually significantly cheaper, and the car was so much better too.
There you go, right? So, market businessman. Mm-hmm. In that manifesto, A Future of Wealth Belongs to You, I dove into comparing and contrasting the career politician, which will say this is a war of two worlds. The career politician, the evil one, and the market businessman, the true hero of society. Now, you know, the ruling class will try to turn that around, try to make the market businessman the evil one, right? And try to make themselves, prop themselves up as the heroes.
Well, you're saying distorting words.
That's right.
And definitions.
The thinking tools and distorting those. And exactly. So they're taking the definition of heroes and they're distorting it to mean villains and vice versa. So I really identified this in my manifesto. Now, I was too young to run. And when Ross Perot came on board, I said, well, now he's a billionaire, right? And I said, there's someone who can really do something. So I immediately stopped my campaigning and my testing the waters. And I sent Ross Perot's campaign to his headquarters, my political manifesto. I got a call from his campaign manager, and that was before, who was the famous guy who took over his campaign? Ed Rollins. That was before Ed Rollins became his campaign manager. And we talked on the phone about this whole thing about career politics. They were fascinated. The person I was talking to was fascinated about this concept of market businessmen versus career politicians. And what I had done in my manifesto and showed the true hero of society and a true villain of society. And basically they asked if I would be fine with them using some of my terminology. And I was thrilled and gave them my blessing and go for it. And Ross Perot really used career politician like no one's ever used it before him with great success. So that was my first sort of dipping my toes in the political arena. Then that was in 1992, and then it was in 2012 when we did the third party, the 12 Visions Party, and we actually had, you know, it was a small time operation, but even in the write-in ballots, our presidential candidate and vice presidential candidate got seventh place in the write-in votes, and that was with no money or force behind us. So the idea itself, the prime law, was beginning to get noticed out there. Mm. But ultimately, I realized that the prime law as an amendment. The political structure is just too big and heavy to make that succeed at that time, at this time. So this is why I've started the digital state with Immortalis. Its constitution is the prime law. And we have some exciting plans to draw in some very powerful, influential, and wealthy people into the cause that could make something really major happen here, hopefully quickly. Mm-hmm. But again, all of this, everything we talked about today, is just getting in there and really understanding our thinking tools, understanding our words, understanding what they mean, knowing who the hero is, who the villain is, knowing what capitalism is and what it is not. It's just a function of bringing together proper concepts through words and then pulling together concepts into puzzles, like puzzle pieces snapping together through NeoThink.
So if people want to know more, what should they do?
If you want to know how to escape the cult and live in a world with no ruling class, where things are soaring, you're wealthy, you're healthy, you're safe, click on the link below, and I'll send you something free of charge.